Gold, marble, chandeliers, money. Welcome to the world of Donald Trump.
He sells sex and dreams and excitement.
Hello, everybody.
That's what everybody wants on some level.
Donald Trump has made himself a multi-billionaire, and he never stops flaunting what he's got.
I just like to say, and I really mean it, that I have the best.
But behind the image is the toughness of a New York builder.
Watch this.
He's challenging, he's very professional, he's very hands-on, and he might be the world's greatest developer.
Nice to see you.
Trump's American dream takes him from luxury buildings and hotels to starring in the original Apprentice series.
Bradford, you're fired.
You're fired.
You're fired.
Now Trump is bringing his brand of showmanship over here, to Scotland.
There will be nothing like this. This will be the greatest golf course anywhere in the world.
But some of the locals aren't that impressed.
If I thought he was coming down here, I'd buy a shotgun. He's got a lot of buckshot in his arse.
With exclusive access to Donald Trump and his family, I want to discover how a young man who survived near bankruptcy went on to make billions. With the help of three glamorous wives.
What you see, that's what you get. He's the real deal.
And his very own beauty pageant.
Tonight, you're going to find out why this is the most talked about event of the week. It's going to be amazing.
Is my hair okay? Nice and fixed.
To find out about Donald Trump, you have to start in New York. It's the center of his world. In fact, you can't escape him here.
Trump Place. Trump World Tower. Trump Soho. Trump Plaza. Trump International. Trump Park Avenue. Trump, everywhere.
There are 21 Trump buildings in the city. My destination is the most famous, Trump Tower, where Trump lives and works.
Hi there, morning. I'm looking for Donald Trump.
Yes, he's on 26th floor.
I'm nervous about our first meeting for one small reason. Trump is a cleanliness freak and says he hates shaking hands.
Oceanfront property. How are you?
Hey.
Nice to see you.
So you do shake hands?
I shake hands with you. What am I going to catch from you? Nothing.
So what was all that stuff about the avoid the handshake?
Well, no, I don't like shaking hands, but with you I don't mind.
Trump travels down to work in the lift from his penthouse.
So how was the commute this morning? What was it, about 20 floors?
The commute this morning was fine. Sit down, please.
No traffic.
It was about 40 floors.
Don't you need fresh air?
Well, I get it. We pump it into the building. I mean, I get up very early. I don't sleep much, 3 or 4 hours, which is good. I read papers, I read statements, I read lots of
things. Does your wife do if you're jumping up and down, you know, 3 hours sleep and then you're out?
Well, she's not complaining. That's the only thing. I don't want to mention it, but she's not complaining. If she sees this, she may start complaining. She says, you know, she's right.
You know, she really has great
guts. This is Trump's apartment. It's probably the world's only Louis XIV-style triplex. And it's home to his third wife, Melania.
He wakes up early and he go ahead and think about, you know, the project, the business, the deals. And I think every successful man, I don't think they need a lot of sleep.
First impression then, your classic type A personality, American tycoon.
What are you worth?
Well, I don't know. It's very hard to say what you're worth, but I would say well over $6 billion, at least $6 billion, and probably substantially higher than that.
What is in the Trump empire now?
Well, we have a lot of things. I mean, lots and lots of land, lots of good buildings. We have a brand that's very, very valuable.
It was a crisis in American property that triggered the financial meltdown of the past couple of years. Trump's business hasn't been immune from the effects, but he says that overall, falling property prices are an opportunity for him.
Now, I'm now buying a lot of things because of the fact that we're in a very strong cash position, and that gives me a certain power. I mean, this is a fantastic time. From my standpoint, this is the best time that I've ever had because I'm buying things that 2 years ago you could have never bought. It would have never been so.
Good morning, the Trump Organization.
You don't have to be a Trump to work here, but it helps. On the floor below, Trump assistant Amanda Miller showed me some more.
So who have we got here, Amanda?
So we have Donald Trump Jr. here.
Is he called Donald?
Donald Trump Jr. or Don Jr.
Right. So.
And here we have Eric Trump as well.
Eric is there, deep in a meeting.
Yes.
Eric Trump, at 26, is the youngest of the three Trumps working for their dad. Next door, his sister.
This is Ivanka's with the beautiful orchids, her favorite.
Ivanka Trump, businesswoman and model. Nepotism? Well, it's a charge they've always had to deal with.
When you get into the corporate world, family business is all of a sudden goes from being something that's aspired to being something that's viewed skeptically. And I've always found that interesting because I don't think it's any different than, you know, being a baker's son. Why is that sort of upheld as a great thing to follow in the footsteps of your family, whereas in big business it's not?
Is it because it's seen as a birthright to, you know, a $6 billion fortune or whatever it is?
Sure, but if we're incompetent, we're losing that which our father has worked so hard to be able to give to us.
Well, listen, they can say whatever they want. I know what it's like to be here. He basically always said, you know, I'll fire you like a dog if I don't think you love what you do, if you're not doing a good job, because I'm not going to, you know, ruin what I've built up over 30 years at your expense or to benefit you. So it's a tough reality, but it is very much reality.
And if they want to ask Dad for a pay rise, what happens? They just jump in the lift and come and see you?
Well, if they deserve it, I give it. And if they don't deserve it, I wouldn't give it. But they're really working hard. Eric, who you met, and Don and Ivanka, they're really working hard and doing a very good job. See, you didn't know Trump could hit a ball like that.
He's 64, but Donald Trump still has one driving ambition.
210 on the green. Not bad, right?
To him, golf is much more than just a game.
Well, I've had a lot of success at golf. I like playing golf. I have fun with it.
It's a pretty long drive, right? All man. All man.
I think I like building courses more than I like playing, but I find building golf courses a very beautiful thing to do.
Trump already owns 9 golf courses in the U.S. Now he wants to expand his collection to Scotland. Aberdeen is experiencing what looks like a state visit. Nobody had associated Trump with Scotland until recently. But now he takes every opportunity to remind us that on his mother's side, he's a MacLeod.
My mother was born in Scotland, in the Hebrides, in Stornoway. So that's serious Scotland. And she was a great woman. I'll never forget, whenever anything was on about ceremonial about the Queen, she could sit at the television and just watch it. She had great respect for the Queen and for everything it represents.
4 years ago, Trump bought this 1,400-acre estate near Aberdeen. He wants to build a £750 million golf resort with a luxury hotel and hundreds of houses. He applied for planning permission.
Could you just wave to us? Just for this camera, sir.
While waiting for the council's verdict, he paid a visit to his mother's home in the Outer Hebrides, accompanied by his sister, Marianne.
I took his hand and I said, "Welcome home." That's how I felt about it.
A room full of long-lost cousins had been lined up.
Hello. I haven't met you, and this is Kate.
Hi there, nice to see you.
No one doubts Trump's enthusiasm for Scotland, but in planning terms, it's also a convenient time to recall his mother's nationality.
I think he wanted to do something in memory of his mother. And I think this is it.
I got both.
Trump has put his oldest son, Don Jr., in charge of his Aberdeenshire development.
Well shot, sir.
Thank you.
Some nice sporting
there. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Don and his brother Eric have also thrown themselves into their Scottish identity.
It's kind of scary. I like wearing a skirt. I'm a little worried, but it's actually very comfortable. I think I'm going to have to get one and wear it to more formal occasions because it's definitely better than the typical tuxedo worn in America.
I think this is going to be a very, very important thing for Scotland.
If we have the clubhouse here, the parking should be here. It shouldn't be over to the side. It should be right behind it.
And hopefully I'll be known in Scotland as having really made a major contribution. I only hope I'm given the chance to do something really terrific for Scotland.
Those were the dunes I stood on last time.
There's no question about Trump's passion for the project.
Every time when he comes back home, and he just said that's the most gorgeous place on earth, it's beautiful.
So the road would come down, it would make a right and then a left in.
He said, I would make the most amazing golf course on the world. So we cross the fingers and I know it will happen.
Not everyone shares Trump's enthusiasm. There's concern about the impact of building on this beautiful coastline and its rare wildlife.
If there's a chance that he can be stopped, we will stop.
It's become a bitterly disputed development.
He's so stubborn in the way that he's doing things, and so bullying in his techniques, is generally just an odious man.
Trump's mother left Scotland and sailed for New York in the 1930s. There, she met and married an ambitious builder, Fred Trump.
My father was a very tough, strong businessman. He was a great negotiator, and he taught me a lot.
He came from a family of self-made men, and his father was notorious for being extremely penny-wise, every single weekend visiting construction sites with the kids, picking up bent nails. Dad worked 7 days a week.
Young Donald went to military school before joining the family firm. Fred Trump had done well in the outer boroughs and never tried to find work in the centre of the city across the river. Where the father was cautious, his son Donald was fearless. Donald's first move was to take the Trump Organization across Brooklyn Bridge to the biggest, toughest, most expensive market in the world, Manhattan.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York.
Trump moved to a Manhattan apartment, determined to drag his father's business into the big league.
You came to Manhattan, you were like this pipsqueak. You said, I'm a developer, give me your money, give me your trust. You had nothing to show for it, right?
I had very little to show for it, other than I did a good job with my father in Brooklyn, and we did really, you know, I did a lot of good jobs out there, and so when I came into Manhattan, I felt confident.
However good it looked from a distance, the Manhattan that Trump found in the early 70s was falling apart. Many of its businesses had declared bankruptcy. Among them, the Penn Central Railroad Company. Ned Eichler was hired to raise money for its creditors by selling off its New York property portfolio.
So the phone rang one day, and a secretary said to me, there's a man named Donald Trump on the phone, and I had never heard of him. And this sort of brash voice comes over the phone, and he said, when are you coming to New York so I can talk to you?
Trump had big ideas. He said he wanted to develop one of the huge properties Eichler was disposing of.
We took a walk in Central Park, and he pointed to all the buildings, and he said, I'm 29 years old. I'm going to be bigger than anybody in New York in 5 years.
Trump's first target was a dilapidated hotel next to Grand Central Station. Der Scutt, a young architect, found himself caught up in Trump's ambitions.
The Commodore Hotel was a rundown, really derelict building at one of the prime locations in New York City. It was absolutely the worst building possible. Donald saw an opportunity.
Here was a young man who nobody had heard of telling people he was a developer. He didn't have a building to his name. And yet, by sheer force of will, he managed to persuade the bankers, lent him millions, and a major hotel chain to sign up to his promises.
Trump gutted the inside of the building and clad the outside in a layer of reflective glass. He borrowed $120 million to transform the old Commodore into a new and defiantly modern Grand Hyatt Hotel. It was the birth of the Trump style.
No limestone, no faded Persian carpets, no walnut paneling, none of that, and no understatement. Absolutely no understatement ever.
So where did this young man find his confidence? Well, strange to say, it may have been in church. The Trumps worshipped here, where the minister was Norman Vincent Peale.
Well, Norman Vincent Peale believed in the power of positive thinking, and he wrote a book called The Power of Positive Thinking. I would listen to him speak even in his 70s, and he was just a fantastic guy. He was a minister, and that was the church I went to.
Peale's message allowed his congregation to feel good about their worldly ambitions.
What is a successful life? To make a lot of money, or to get your name in the paper? Well, conceivably, it could be.
We were brought up with that as very much a tenet of faith. The Gospels say, in the end, all will be well. Out of bad comes good. The power of positive thinking. And I think that's very much in Donald's makeup.
You got to accent to aid the positive and eliminate the negative and latch on to the affirmative, but don't mess with Mr. In Between.
For Trump, positive thinking means success, and success is everything.
I think success brings great enjoyment, and certainly it has for me. Trump National Golf Club is a tremendous success, and it's also been a very successful course. So I had a lot of success.
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 But now it's a really great success.
I want to find out how Trump runs his businesses. I'm on my way to his golf course in Westchester, just outside New York. This is how he hopes the Aberdeen project will turn out a few years from now.
So Emily, this is the ballroom at Trump National Westchester. It holds about 700 people. And I was telling you...
Showing me round is Eric Trump.
You know, this is what we're going to do in Scotland. This is really the final product. Ballroom's beautiful.
You might want to check the prices before signing up.
We have 300 members. Their initiation fee is over $300,000 to get in, so it's a steep price ticket, but...
Are there queues for that? Is there a long waiting list, or can you join immediately?
There is a waiting list.
And how much would they pay per year, or How does that work?
It differs club to club, but here it's about $20,000 a year. Should we get a look at the rest of the clubhouse?
Sure.
And Eric says they'd be charging those sort of fees in Scotland too.
So Emily, I'll take you up to the men's locker room.
Yeah, well, that's a first for me.
It's the kind of club where you don't need to remember your locker number.
Well, Clint Eastwood, Mayor Rudolph Giuliani, Jack Nicholson. Oh, yeah, President William J. Clinton. So that's
very good friend of ours. Very nice
that's,
man.
That's so. Quite a locker room.
But it's not till you get to the bathroom that you really experience the full-on Trump style.
People want the dark woods. They want the beautiful marbles. This is the finest quality Breccia marble.
You know, Breccia, it's really, where does that come from then?
It comes from Italy. That's what people expect, and that's what they expect from Trump. And ultimately, that's why they pay the membership that they do. They want to be a part of the best, and they want to be able to bring their friends and colleagues here and show them this beauty.
What would this be, gold-plated?
It is gold-plated.
It's very fancy, Eric. Mm-hmm. Would you call it showy?
Certainly. I would hope it's showy. That's fine. So welcome back, everybody.
As Eric gave a pre-season pep talk to the staff, I'd seen he could walk the walk and talk the talk.
Team ready?
Appreciate it. We're ready to go, Mr. Trump. Yes, sir.
But had he really earned his job?
People don't realize that when we're building a new hotel, a couple days ago, Ivanka and myself and Don were in a room with 40 mattresses choosing the new mattress for the hotel collection. We choose every sheet. We choose every paint color, every mirror, every TV. We negotiate those deals.
So what about if I asked you, you know, to name the grass that you use out on the golf course, or if I ask you about, you know, who commissioned the art or where the chairs come from or who made the sofa? Are you that hands-on?
Absolutely. And quite frankly, we've negotiated every single one of those deals. In most cases, we've picked out the various
Go on, tell
furniture.
Me, what's the grass out there then?
That's Pas Palm out there.
And what about that chandelier?
Schoenbeck makes these chandeliers.
Sounds like it's German.
Austrian, actually.
Austrian.
So.
Long before Eric was born, his father ran the Trump Organization like a family business. First to be drawn in was a Czech-born former ski champion and model, Ivana Winkelmeier, who was almost as ambitious as he was.
He wooed her very ardently. She, as who wouldn't, was quite taken with whipping around New York City in a limo and with the prospect of being part of this growing dynasty.
Donald and Ivana got married, and Ivana quickly became part of Trump's business life with a desk in the office and a top management job. She was by his side for his next project, the one that made his name.
Well, Trump Tower was one of my earlier battles, and at the time it was very, very controversial because it's a very tall building. It's 68 stories, and it's right next to Tiffany, which is a very iconic building that's been there a long time.
Trump wanted his new building to be massive. He knew that each building in the city had so-called air rights, permission to build up to a maximum height. He also knew that air rights were a tradable commodity.
When Donald Trump saw that the neighboring building, Tiffany, was pretty small, a few stories high, meaning it hadn't bothered to claim its air rights, he bought them. That meant his building could be even taller.
It was incredibly difficult because the building kept growing taller and taller and taller. And he realized that the value he paid for the air rights was a small token in maybe quadrupling the price he would get for the real estate up in the sky.
In 1982, the apartments went on sale, starting at $500,000. They were such a success that they paid for the whole building, even before Trump sold the retail space at the bottom. There, he created a huge atrium, taking the Trump style to a new level.
Shiny, very shiny. Everything shiny, and it's more shiny than that. and pink marble. Who would ever have pink marble? And a whole lobby covered with that, with a waterfall? Get out. That was very new.
Nearly 30 years on, it's still a tourist attraction.
Trump Tower has become a really iconic building in New York now, and we have tremendous people living here, whether it's Steven Spielberg or Andrew Lloyd Webber or so many others. They live in Trump Tower,
they're
and they
still
love
here.
Trump Tower. And they're here.
By a small town blues, they are.
But the only name that really counts is the one on the outside of the building, the one its developer had given it. And in turn, Trump Tower made Donald Trump a name to be reckoned with in New York.
If I can make it there, I'll make it.
There was a story in the paper that the Queen of England was going to leave Buckingham Palace and move into Trump Tower. So they asked me whether or not it was true, and I said no comment, and so they assumed it was true. I mean, nobody.
Trump would like everybody in America to be talking about him all the time. Money was just part of the fame, but fame was the real goal.
Trump soon realized he could sell the fame he'd created. He already had lots to say about his achievements. The Art of the Deal was part autobiography, part self-help book, a kind of power of positive thinking for the 1980s.
What do you think people are going to get out of it if they read it? People don't deal in multi-billion dollar buildings. I mean,
no.
What can someone at home on a $30,000...
It's really a study of life, Kathleen, how to do it and how to really make life.
How to make life.
How to make life. How to be with life and how to live with life.
And the formula seemed to work. Trump's business went into overdrive with more buildings, a massive yacht, even a Trump airline.
Life was very exciting. You really felt like you were in a movie. I mean, you could go into his office and he was talking to Frank Sinatra on the phone, and Frank Sinatra had called him.
The Aberdeen project is moving ahead. Trump has won permission to build the golf course, although the hotel and housing that goes with it has yet to get final approval.
Pretty spectacular view, right?
Don Jr. is visiting to inspect progress.
Well, it finally feels like a construction site after 5 years of, you know, effort to get to this point. I mean, we're really underway. It's a great feeling. It really is special to us in this world, and we're going to make something incredible here.
But this area is home to a handful of people, some of whom are refusing to cooperate with Trump's plans. Michael Forbes owns 23 acres. He's been living here for over 40 years.
I love it here. I like the peace. But I haven't had much of that since Trump came in ago.
One of Trump's managers approached Forbes in the hope of buying him out.
He says, we'll give you $350,000 for your place. I said, no. And, they wanted to lift up my house and jack it up and put it away over at the end of the beach there, you know? There's stupid things they were coming out with. So I says, well, I've heard enough. And then Trumpy started having his tantrums on the TV about me. Yeah.
His property is a slum. In the United States, we call it a slum. When you have tractors that are rotting and rusting into this beautiful sand, when you have oil tanks that are leaking into the sand, I mean, I think somebody should do something about it.
Quite happy with the way it is. Why the hell should I change my property to suit them, you know?
Forbes' land isn't needed to build the golf course. It won't even be needed for the hotel. But to Trump, it's still a big problem.
If we build a $300 or $400 million hotel, I don't think anybody wants to build where your view is obliterated by a slum. I think that he really wants to sell it. He just wants much more money than the property's worth.
But Forbes says he's staying put.
The only thing Trump understands is money and Trump. That's all he cares about, is money and Trump. He could take his money and shove it up his arse. I don't care about his money.
And the American Airlines used to say, if you've got it, flaunt it. This couple certainly have it. Let's meet them. Please welcome, ladies and gentlemen, Donald and Diana Trump.
Even if not everyone was quite sure of their names, by the late 80s, Donald and Ivana were A-list celebrities.
1989, I was the hottest. One of the big magazines said, everything he touches turns to gold. And my father said the same thing about me. Everything he touches turns to gold. And I thought I was sort of invincible. And then in 1990, you had the great real estate depression. And all of a sudden, I didn't feel so invincible.
Just as Donald Trump was emerging as a unique symbol of success, away from the public eye, his vast empire was actually imploding. The late 80s recession had taken its toll on a business that was growing too fast.
The expansion of Trump's businesses had come at a price. Huge sums borrowed from banks.
The storm clouds are gathering over the empire of the flamboyant New York property developer Donald Trump. Trump has already missed the deadline for 2 out of 3 interest payments. He now has 10 days to raise enough cash or be forced to file for bankruptcy protection.
I didn't think I was necessarily over-levered, meaning lots of financing, but all of a sudden when the values come down, you're over-levered. The leverage stays the same, but the value starts to drop. I was very, very tight, and we had a big problem.
Being hundreds of millions of pounds in the red became a Trump story of what he said to a friend about a homeless man.
I was walking down Fifth Avenue, and there was a man in front of Tiffany, and he was holding a can. And I said, do you know that man is wealthier than me? And she looked at me, she said, what are you talking about? I said, that man across the street is worth $900 million more than me at this very moment.
Trump's story was a kind of boast. You had to be big to get that much in debt. Trump started to become as famous a failure as he'd been a success.
He dealt with it like a general at a war table in figuring out how he was going to fix it. I think it was a time of tremendous introspection for him, but I don't think he lost any time thinking, oh, poor me or poor everybody, what's going to happen to us all? His way is to say, okay, I'm going to fix this.
In the end, it was Trump's name that saved him. The banks decided not to pull the plug on his empire because he'd made himself essential as the star of his own business.
He was one of the first to getting his name on things, getting his name associated with luxury, getting his name associated with all of his extensive financial holdings, and making himself the central character would make him the irreplaceable piece. And that makes you too big to fail. He discovered that early on. Being too big to fail would ensure his continuation.
Trump has his own version of what happened.
I never went bankrupt, but I was certainly in trouble. And it came out that the banks really did like me a lot, and they respected me, and they respected what I did.
He had to give up his yacht. He had to give up some of the frills, but he maintained the core properties and went forward.
And did his lifestyle change at all?
Not that anyone ever noticed.
Alongside his business crisis, Trump had domestic problems. Ivana sensed that, in her husband's eyes, her most important job was done.
We have 3 children, and they age 11, 7, and 4. And the first one was a boy, which was fantastic. The pressure was off. The second one was a girl, which is just adorable. And the third one was a boy again. So my job, it's done. I said, that's it. Shop, it's closed.
The Donald and Ivana show was coming to a spectacular end.
The marriage ultimately got a little bit tired, as it happens. And, you know, I don't even blame anything on it. You know, it's very tough, in my opinion, for a woman to compete with my business.
It wasn't just business that was distracting Trump from his wife. He was having an affair with a young actress called Marla Maples, which put Donald and Ivana on a collision course.
The war of the Trumps has ignited a battle of the tabloids.
Sex, infidelity, power, lust.
A divorce worth millions under bitter dispute.
Do you wish we'd all go away?
Absolutely.
Trump divorced Ivana, and a year later, he and Marla tied the knot.
It was a beautiful evening. It was really a beautiful evening, and people are very happy.
Trump's children saw their parents' split played out in the media. Today, they put a positive spin on the trauma.
Well, media always wants a sob story. They wanted to pick the three kids who were going through it. And, you know, certainly the story was there, but again, our parents did a great job of shielding us from that. And we really, you know, we felt it without feeling it.
There definitely is a downside to being in the public eye. I think with that said, for the most part, we've been able to harness it and use it as a great tool for our business. I think that's just, you know, what one has to deal with when they are in the public eye, and I think we've all grown to accept it.
Trump's split with Ivana was only his first divorce. His marriage to Marla soon went the same way. More than 10 years later, Trump has climbed back. He's with his third wife, the Slovenian-born model, Melania Knaus.
This is a real honor being with so many people tonight.
Two divorces and near bankruptcy. It's done nothing to dent his confidence.
The golf courses I have are the best in the world, and they're acknowledged to be the best in the world.
That should be perfect.
Our hotel in New York is the highest-rated hotel in New York. The neighbors love us, the environmentalists love us, everybody. They think it's just fantastic. And since then, I've had 10 number one bestsellers.
No matter where I go in the world, people want me. In fact, I'm on the cover of Golf Magazine this week. You should get it.
Self-promotion? Trump just calls it a day's work. And today, there are even more Trump buildings to be talked up. Like this one, the tallest residential building in New York. I wanted to find out what life is like for the new generation of super-rich Trump customers.
So this is the living room?
Drew Aaron lives on the 77th floor.
Is there anything you can't see from here?
A few things, but you have a pretty good view of New York. You can see...
It's the UN.
The UN is right here.
So we're looking down onto the top of the UN building.
Great view, but is there anything really different about this property?
Do you notice there is something that makes this building Trump, or is it just the name?
It's a lot more than just the name. Obviously, with Donald having his name on the building, he cares a lot about the building. He stops here every couple months. He'll go through the elevators, he'll go through the lobbies. If he doesn't like the flowers, he'll have them removed. If he sees a piece of furniture in the lobby that he doesn't like, you'll notice a week later it won't be there. So he is very hands-on, which is great. So this is the media room.
Drew wouldn't say how much he paid for this place, but similar apartments in the building sell for $8 to $10 million.
Watch TV, and what's nice about being here is you're so high up, it's so quiet, you don't hear the noises of Manhattan.
Drew's convinced that part of what he's paying for is Donald Trump.
If this was just a tall skyscraper in Manhattan and not the Trump World Tower without Donald's backing and marketing and his branding behind it, I don't think that the values would be near as high as they are. So this is the master suite.
Drew's made his fortune trading paper.
Are you really that tidy, Drew, or does somebody...
After buying this place, any spare cash he has left over, he spends on art.
And that looks like Damien Hirst.
That is Damien Hirst. We had a lot of fun with Hirst. It's peaceful, it's very tranquil, and it also has a New York feel.
Today, Trump cashes in on the value attached to his name. The real owners of some of these new Trump buildings in New York are low-profile investors. But the properties sold under his name.
The brand that you, if you like, lend out to other buildings, I mean, is that a major part of what you do now?
Right, well, it's a part of what I do. I will use the name Trump on somebody else's building. So what we'll do is we'll form partnerships, and I call them branding deals, where they use the name Trump, a Trump Tower, and they get better pricing.
Bright light city, gonna set my soul, gonna set my soul on fire.
Just as he was ahead of the trend when he put himself at the center of his brand, Trump's business has also made what's become a classic journey from upmarket to mass market. Today, Trump's American dream is open to all. This is one of a handful of new Trump hotels. You can stay here in Las Vegas for well under £100 a night. For many of the guests, Trump was as much of a draw as the hotel.
What does Donald Trump say to you?
A little glitzy, maybe.
Yeah, a little over the top.
And you like that?
Well, yeah, we do.
I really like Donald Trump, so there was just like, oh, I would like to stay in his hotel.
What does Donald Trump say to you? Success.
Success.
And when it comes to style, Trump believes he knows what people really want.
Donald Trump manages to get people to like things that other trends in culture tell them not to like. Gold and brass and over-the-top posh decor. These are things where if you follow the politically correct storyline of recent years, no, that's not cool. But Donald Trump lets me look at it and go, maybe that's not so bad. Maybe it's okay to like shiny things. Maybe it's okay to like money.
It was probably inevitable that Trump would make the short journey from showman to show business.
Hi, great. How are you doing?
How are you?
Perhaps it was also unsurprising his first venture in showbiz would be a beauty pageant.
Mackenzie Green. She thinks that pollution is the number one problem facing America today.
Katie Whittier. She enjoys drinking chocolate milkshakes and dancing a tango.
Julie Citro. She has three cats, two dogs, and a pet squirrel.
Miss USA was invented to sell swimsuits in the 1950s. 15 years ago, it was in trouble as a business, and Trump came to the rescue. He bought the contest and has revived it.
I think beautiful women will always attract people and eyeballs, meaning it'll always attract people to watch, which ultimately is what it's all about.
What do you say to people who call it an anachronism? I mean, you look at it, it's kind of spangly girls in spangly dresses talking about their pets, right?
I think the old line beauty pageants, maybe you can look at them as an anachronism, but you can't when you come to Miss USA. These girls are incredible, and the ratings are incredible, and NBC loves us, and really the world in terms of Miss Universe, they embrace it.
Virginia.
The new show's as glitzy as any Trump hotel lobby, but there are also some tough questions to answer.
I think we need to figure out better ways of finding alternative energy fuels and reducing our dependency on oil in general. So I hope that happens. Thank you. Thank you, Paula. Thanks.
But don't worry, guys. They haven't cut the swimsuit round. For Trump, buying a TV beauty contest was only the warm-up for his big break on television. Venice Beach, California. In the late 80s, a British ex-paratrooper had arrived in the States seeking his fortune. He was selling T-shirts to scrape a living.
From Monday through Thursday afternoon, not many people strolling by. And to fill the time, I would read The Art of the Deal by Donald Trump, which was totally inspiring. And it's that sort of stuff that really, really drew me to Donald Trump.
Fast forward 20 years and, having learnt the art of the deal, Burnett is one of the world's top TV producers with series like Survivor. He has an idea for a new show, so driving into New York, he cold calls the Trump Organization.
Donald Trump answered the phone himself. I had this moment of, well, shall I hang up? And, you know, and then I just had some courage and said, hey, Mr. Trump, it's Mark Burnett. He said, hey, Survivor guy, what do you want? I have an idea. It's a great business show idea, and I really want to come in and tell you about it. He said, well, you know where Trump Tower is. I'm here right now. Now's a great time. Come right on over.
Trump loved the idea and landed himself the role of the original star and the co-owner of what became NBC's top show and a global TV franchise.
Who will succeed and who will fail and who will be the apprentice?
I think it's been really good for me, but it's made my life tougher. I used to be able to walk out on the street, and I was well known before, but I could walk out on the street and, you know, walk someplace. Now I can't do that.
Frankly, if you were running a company and made that kind of a decision, you destroy that company instantaneously. Bradford, you're fired.
Oh my God.
We walked down the streets, people were screaming, you fired, and everybody were thinking that they were the first one to say, you fired.
You're fired.
The Apprentice is powerful marketing for Trump.
Before The Apprentice hit, Donald Trump was primarily an East Coast celebrity. Now with The Apprentice, all of a sudden he's in everybody's living room, all across the country. Hey, that's that guy I heard about. He's that New York guy. All of a sudden, he's a national entertainment figure.
You're fired.
Never one to miss an opportunity, Trump has turned that fame to his advantage. Kathy Glosser licenses the Trump name to other companies.
There's a consumer out there that wants a piece of the Trump lifestyle, and many of them may not be able to afford to live in one of Donald's very expensive apartment buildings, but the affordable luxury concept that we've created would enable them to have a piece of the Trump lifestyle, wearing his tie.
So you'd sort of flash your tie,
no,
would you?
No. It's really about the affordable luxury.
Today you can even sleep on a Trump.
Donald Trump builds hotels and builds homes and apartment buildings, and it's a natural progression for the brand to fill the homes that he builds.
But if none of this appeals and you'd like something more personal,
you can get your hands on your very own Trump doll, complete with catchphrases.
Try to avoid shaking hands whenever possible.
There's one final and vital ingredient that completes the Trump brand.
When I'm talking to people at home, I say I'm off to meet Donald Trump next week, and they're all, ah, skyscrapers and hair. Why do people always say?
Yeah, they're killing me on the hair. It is actually my hair. It's real. If you want to inspect it, you know, but it is actually my hair. I get accused of wearing a hairpiece or a wig or whatever they would call it, but it's not true. I don't have a hairpiece or anything, but a lot of people think I do.
When one of his developments needs a push, for instance, to encourage local politicians, Trump knows how to use his brand to build momentum. The showman takes his show on the road.
Hello, everybody.
We're about to be treated to a classic Trump performance. The golf course near Aberdeen has been under construction for a few months. There are still objectors to his plans for housing and a hotel, but this event makes it look like a done deal.
Well, I'd like to thank everybody for being here, but much more importantly for their tremendous support. We have so many friends in the audience, and they've been...
Trump's
really
determination to build a golf course here is all about the sand dunes, which he's fallen in love with.
The dunes are among the largest in the world, and I decided that in honor of my mother and in honor of Scotland,
renamed the dunes the Great Dunes of Scotland.
What does that mean to you, the Great Dunes of Scotland?
Well, I think it's an important name. I think it's a much more important than Meanie. It was called Meanie, and I think it's a much more important name. It's dedicated to my mother, and it's dedicated to the people of Scotland. So I'm calling them, henceforth, the Great Dunes of Scotland.
Trump is also having a more practical impact on these dunes.
I wonder if Trump's favourite preacher, Norman Vincent Peale, ever quoted Matthew 7, verse 24 at him. "'Tis a foolish man who builds his house on sand." Presumably the same could apply for hotels or holiday lets. But I'm sure that foolish man, unlike Donald Trump, never considered a dune stabilisation programme.
Trump is having a special kind of grass planted on the dunes to stop them changing shape and messing up the course he's building through them.
We've saved the dunes, and a lot of these dunes would not be saved. They can blow away with the winds, and we've saved the dunes, we've stabilized the dunes, and from an environmental standpoint, it's a much better situation than it was before we bought the site.
But environmentalists say these are a rare example of so-called mobile dunes with a special ecology which depends on their being blown into new shapes all the time.
You talk about the uniqueness of these dunes. That uniqueness comes from their ability to change and to modify. That's what makes them an incredible piece of land.
Well, they'll still be changing and modifying, but to a lesser extent, and now they're stabilized. And actually, for years, people have been stabilizing dunes, and they consider it a good thing, not a bad thing.
Trump hasn't persuaded everyone on that, or on the merits of building here at all. Part of the dunes are designated a site of special scientific interest.
When Scottish National Heritage, for example, says it will create a lasting adverse impact on the environment.
Well, I think that if you really read up on this, which probably you haven't, you'll see that most environmental groups have supported us. We've had tremendous support from the environmental groups, and so I'm very happy about that.
Who's next?
Trump's project was the subject of a public inquiry. The seven environmental groups that gave evidence were all against his plans.
How about this?
Trump also has support from many local people who welcome the investment and jobs his project will bring.
Good?
Thank you.
To get deals done, Trump's written, he aims high and just keeps pushing and pushing and pushing.
Have a good time, fellas.
Thank you.
In The Art of the Deal, he also explains how he creates his own kind of hype by accentuating the positive. I call it truthful hyperbole. It's an innocent form of exaggeration and a very effective form of promotion. It's hard to spot Trump's truthful hyperbole.
You're fired.
But what about this?
93% of the people in Aberdeen were in favor of this job.
As you know, we have 93% approval rating in the polls. 93%.
93%. That's almost impossible.
I've never even heard of 93.
I would venture to say if we took a poll today, it would be even higher than that.
We've tried to find that. We couldn't find what poll it was.
Yeah, it's one of the newspapers. I can get it for you.
A spokesman for the Trump Organization couldn't come up with that poll, but said 93% is typical of the results of countless polls. Well, that's showbiz.
To be successful in business, you have to put up a good front. Life is not all sincerity. Life is an act to a large extent.
Trump has been playing Trump from this desk for 30 years. On the floor below, there are three candidates being trained as the next top Trump.
Which of the three kids is going to take over from you?
Well, that's a tough question, but I will say that what I'd like to see is that they're all equal. I've never been a big believer in that. You always need a boss. You always need somebody out there to say you're hired, you're fired. But it's very tough to do with your children.
Would it work if it divided into different areas, do you think?
That's one thing. I mean, I'm starting to think about that because that's a very difficult
question you're asking. You know, it's usually easier when you have one boss, but they're very equal. They're very, very capable kids, and they're all doing a good job.
Who's going to take over?
You know what? It's an interesting thing. We don't actually talk about it that much. I think we've all decided that we've seen many families in similar situations break up when they have that war over who's going to take over. And ultimately, I think we've realized that we each have our strong points and probably some of our own weak points. And we recognize that working together is going to be a lot more effective than, you know, fighting over nonsense, because who knows what my father decides to do anyway.
Trump's done it his way for decades. But how much has he really achieved in business?
Very proud, huh?
Part of his formula, alongside openness to the media, is secrecy about his finances. Trump's never floated his business on the stock market, which might have made him a lot of money. But he prefers not being answerable to shareholders and being able to keep his financial affairs to himself.
How rich is he? No one really knows, because everything he owns is private. He has never gone public, which means that his books are not open to scrutiny. And whenever his fortune is estimated, he always complains that he's actually richer than that.
Trump told me he's worth
at least $6 billion and probably substantially higher than that.
But the authoritative Forbes Rich List has him down at just $2.4 billion.
A lot of figures bandied around about what you're actually worth. Forbes says something very different to the figures that you give out.
I mean, they don't know my assets like I know my assets. And I would say that I see people on the list that are at a high level, and I sure as hell wouldn't switch my assets for theirs. I know these people. I know what they have. I know exactly what they have, and I wouldn't switch. But Forbes has me down at $2 and $3 billion. But again, you know, I'm a private company. People don't know my assets.
Donald Trump grew up in a wealthy family. But in other ways, his story fits straight into the American dream.
I think the American public sees him as the part of the American dream where you take big chances and you risk big failure. But because it's America, you're not doomed for all eternity after that.
Typically, Trump doesn't want to accept a role in anyone else's story.
I don't think of myself as the American dream. I think of myself as somebody that really enjoys what he does. I've created a lot of good things for a lot of people, including jobs. But I'm not sure that that's necessarily the American dream.
Whatever he may think, Trump's is a story of our time. From bricks and mortar to brands and marketing.
His father built homes for ordinary people. Donald Trump built fantasies and sold those to rich people. Today, he markets to everyone, through television, through the products he licenses, and through his children. While his empire appears unwieldy, it's actually very simple, because the only thing he's ever really sold is Donald Trump.
Well, I think that was a nice ending.
It was.
I feel good about it.
Yeah, it's great.